Today, we'll be looking at the trillion transistor chip that just left a supercomputer in the dust. If you're new to this channel, welcome. This is Mr. Singularity, where we explore the scientific and technological breakthroughs shaping the future as we know it. The history of computer chips is a thrilling story of extreme miniaturization. The smaller, the better is a trend that has given birth to the digital world as we know it. So why would you want to reverse course and make chips a lot bigger on Earth? Well, while there is no particularly good reason to have an iPad-sized chip on an iPad, such a chip may prove to be genius for more specific uses, such as artificial intelligence or physical world simulations. At least that's what Cerebras, the creator of the world's biggest computer chip, hopes for. The Cerebras wafer scale engine is massive, no matter how you cut it. The chip is 8.5 inches to the side and contains 1.2 trillion transistors. The next biggest chip, the NVIDIA A100 GPU, measures just 1 inch at a time and has only 54 billion transistors. The former is new, largely untested, and to date, one of a kind. The latter is well-loved, mass-produced, and has taken over the AI and supercomputing world in the last decade. So, can Goliath turn the script on David? Cerebras has a mission to find that out. Great chips beyond AI. When Cerebras came out of stealth for the first time last year, the company said it could significantly speed up the training of deep learning models. Since then, the WSE has made its way into a handful of supercomputing labs where the company's customers are going through their paces. One of those labs, the National Energy Technology Laboratory, is looking to see what can be done beyond AI. So in a recent study, researchers pitted the chip, which is housed in an all-in-one system about the size of a dorm room mini-fridge called the CS1, against a supercomputer in a fluid dynamics simulation. Simulation of fluid movements is a common supercomputer application that is useful for solving complex problems such as weather forecasting and aircraft wing design. The trial was described in a preprint paper written by a team led by Cerebras' Michael James and NETL's Dirk van Essendelft and presented at the SC20 Supercomputing Conference this week. The team said that the CS1 had completed a combustion simulation in a power plant approximately 200 times faster than the Joule 2.0 supercomputer had taken on a similar task. Actually, the CS1 was faster than real time. As Cerebras wrote in a blog post, it can tell you what's going to happen in the future faster than the laws of physics produce the same result. Researchers said that the performance of the CS1 could not match any number of CPUs and GPUs. And CEO and co-founder Andrew Feldman said VentureBeat would be true no matter how big a supercomputer is. At one point, scaling a supercomputer like Joule doesn't produce any better results in this kind of problem. That's why Joule's simulation speed peaked at 16,384 cores, a fraction of its total of 86,400 cores. The comparison between the two machines drives the point home. Joule is the 81st fastest supercomputer in the world, packs dozens of server rackets, consumes up to 450 kilowatts of power, and needs tens of millions of dollars to build. The CS1, by comparison, fits into a third of the server rack, consumes 20 kilowatts of power, and sells for a few million dollars. While the task is niche but useful and the problem is well suited to the CS1, it's still a pretty stunning result. So how are they going to pull it off? It's all about design. Cut down the commute. Computer chips begin life on a large piece of silicon called a wafer. Multiple chips are etched onto the same wafer, and the wafer is then cut into individual chips. While the WSE is also etched on a silicon wafer, the wafer remains intact as a single operating unit. This wafer-scale chip contains nearly 400,000 processing cores. Each core is linked to its own dedicated memory and its four adjacent cores. Putting that many cores on a single chip and giving them their own memory is why the WSE is bigger. That's also why, in this case, it's better. Most large-scale computing tasks depend on massive parallel processing. Researchers are distributing the task to hundreds or thousands of chips. The chips need to work in concert, so they're in constant communication, shuttling information back and forth. A similar process takes place within each chip, as the information moves between the processor cores that make the calculations and the shared memory to store the results. it's kind of like an old-fashioned company doing all its business on paper. The company uses couriers to send and collect documents from other branches and archives across the city. The couriers know the best routes through the city, but the journeys take a minimum amount of time, determined by the distance between the branches and the archives, the top speed of the courier, and the number of other couriers on the road. In short, the distance and the traffic slow down. Now imagine that same company building a brand new, gleaming skyscraper. Every branch is moved to a new building, and every worker has a small filing cabinet in his office to store documents. Now, any document they need can be stored and retrieved in the time it takes to move across the office or down the hall to their neighbor's office. The information exchange has all but vanished. It's all in the same house. The megachip of Cerebras is a bit like this skyscraper. The way it shuttles information, with the help of its specially tailored compiling software, is far more efficient than a traditional supercomputer that needs a ton of traditional chips to be networked. Simulation of the world as it unfolds. It's worth noting that the chip can only handle problems small enough to fit on the wafer, but such problems may have quite practical applications because of the machine's ability to perform high-fidelity simulation in real time. The authors note, for example, that the machine should theoretically be able to accurately simulate the flow of air around a helicopter trying to land on a flight deck and semi-automate the process, something that is not possible with traditional chips. Another opportunity, they note, would be to use simulation as input to train a neural network that also resides on a chip. In an intriguing and related example, Caltech's machine learning technique recently proved to be 1,000 times faster in solving the same kind of partial differential equations at play here to simulate fluid dynamics. They also note that improvements in the chip and others like it, should they arrive, will push back the limits of what can be achieved. Cerebras has already teased the release of its next generation chip, which will have 2.6 trillion transistors, 85,000 cores, and more than double the memory. Of course, it still remains to be seen whether wafer scale computing really does take off. The idea has been around for decades, but Cerebras is the first to seriously pursue it. They clearly believe that they have solved the problem in a way that is both useful and economical. Other new architectures are also being pursued in the lab. MEM-resistor-based neuromorphic chips, for example, mimic the brain by applying processing and memory to individual transistor-like components. And of course, quantum computers are in a separate lane, but they tackle similar problems. It could be that one of these technologies will eventually rise to govern all of them. Or, and this seems just as likely, computing may splinter into a bizarre quilt of radical chips, all stitched together to make the most of each of them, depending on the situation. What's your take on this? Let me know down in the comments below, and check out one of these other videos. This has been Mr. Singularity, and I'll see you on the next one.